Welcome to St. Peter's Episcopal Church. I'm glad you've joined us for this live stream of Sunday morning lessons and prayers. My name is Furman Buchanan. Serving with me today is the Reverend Marie Cope, our associate priest. Also, Kimberly Rhodes will be our cantor and vocalist. Craig Pipo is our organist. And Kim Buchanan is helping with the internet. A special thanks before we begin also to Laura Lipscomb and Jan Rhodes, who are continuing to offer much support digitally for our youth and children and families, communities within St. Peter's. I'm glad you're here. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty and everlasting God, who in the Paschal mystery established the new covenant of reconciliation, grant that all who have been reborn into the fellowship of Christ's body may show forth in their lives what they profess by their faith. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
You may be seated for the lessons. This is a reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with deeds of power, wonders, and signs that God did through him among you, as you yourselves know, this man, handed over to you according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of those outside the law. But God raised him up, having freed him from death, because it was impossible for him to be held in its power. For David says concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand, so that I will not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad and my tongue rejoiced. Moreover, my flesh will live in hope. For you will not abandon my soul to Hades or let your Holy One experience corruption. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. Fellow Israelites, I may say to you confidently of our ancestor David, that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Since he was a prophet, he knew that God had sworn with an oath to him that he would put one of his descendants on his throne. Foreseeing this, David spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, saying, "He was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh experience corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that all of us are witnesses." The word of the Lord.
Thanks
be to God. Reading from the first letter of Peter. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who are being protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, even if now for a little while you have had to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, being more precious than gold, that, though perishable, is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Although you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy, for you are receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. They are scared and angry and sad and confused and holed up in a house with a door closed, avoiding contact with the outside world. The world as they know it has turned upside down. Their routines upended, their work no longer deemed essential. The nights are long, and sleep is fitful. They wonder if tomorrow will be more of the same. They are friends of mine who have worked in the food service industry a long time, furloughed for a few weeks now. Money is really tight. Their stimulus check hasn't arrived, and their son, who has type 1 diabetes, needs his meds. They whisper among themselves their questions, their doubts, their fears. Why? What do we do now? What's next? They are frustrated and tired and just want things to go back to the way they were. Peace be with you, they hear. And there he is, just like Mary said, bringing tidings of peace. Jesus enters the depths of their despair. They know that they had fallen asleep that night in the garden when Jesus asked for them to pray for him. They had denied him. They weren't strong enough to stand in solidarity with him at the bottom of that cross and watch him die. The last time the disciples saw Jesus, the spittle of his accusers mingled with blood as it ran down his face from the crown of thorns. And his body, weary from fatigue and abuse, was broken and dying. And the first thing he says is a word of peace. He displays his hands and his side as if to say, I'm fine, it's fine, everything is as it should be. Jesus, who miraculously stands before them, has been restored. He is the embodiment of wholeness. All the stories and insights and teachings Jesus shared fell into place. What he said is true, and the disciples discover for themselves a new life in the resurrected Christ, and they rejoice. Peace be with you, he says again. Jesus commissions his followers to go out and to do his work in the world, to go and do the next right thing. And he gives them this gift of the Holy Spirit so they would always be equipped to carry out that work. And Thomas, who wasn't there to witness this appearance, is dubious of his friend's claim that they, like Mary before them, have seen the Lord. Jesus was a good friend, a provocative teacher, a charismatic prophet even, but returned from the dead? I was living in Alexandria, Virginia in my last year of seminary when the Pentagon, about 4 miles away as a crow flies, was hit on 9/11. That night, I sat on the roof of our seminary's administrative building and watched the Pentagon burn. I was up there with a classmate for many hours, feeling disoriented, scared for my safety and that of many others whom I cared about. I was angry and sad and confused, and the story of Jesus appearing to the disciples ran like a loop in my mind. And I kept returning to the same question: how exactly does one abide in the peace of God in the midst of tragedy? Up on that roof, I reflected on my day, how I saw my classmates and professors shift into gear to be helpers in the world. Some of us showed up at the local hospital and offered to do whatever needed doing. One went down to the Pentagon and assisted the first responders. Others began organizing relief efforts to help families directly impacted by the day's events, and the rest gathered in prayer. Helpers were everywhere. Jesus was everywhere. It's nearly 20 years later, and I'm seeing helpers everywhere now, too. Jesus is everywhere now, too. Jesus is in the compassionate persistence of those who are healthy, continuing to stay home so that the vulnerable are better protected. Jesus is on the phone calling this person and that person to check in and make sure that all is okay. Jesus is showing up at the grocery store when someone gets one, not two, packages of toilet paper when it is miraculously in stock. Jesus shows up as medical personnel, emergency workers, postal carriers, grocery deliverers, and hospital chaplains. Jesus appears as the creative, compassionate, endurance-filled school teachers who are coaching up and supporting parents as well as their students during distance learning, and as all those who are ensuring that the children of our communities have food to eat while school is out. And Jesus is appearing in the technology that is facilitating communication and the building of relationships, as well as allowing us to worship together this morning despite our intentional distancing. Jesus is in the buckets overflowing with food and diapers outside on the front porch of this church every week. Jesus is everywhere. Jesus is even there during our sleepless nights as we long for our loved ones to be safe and healthy. Thomas's eyes don't perceive him. His soul is so distraught that he needs to know that God gets it, that God understands what he's feeling and thinking and how upside down he feels his world is. So for Thomas, he'll believe Jesus is present if he can see the scars, evidence of the life he lived and the death that Jesus died. And then, there he is. He comes among them again and says, "Peace be with you." Jesus goes on to tell Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands? Put your hand in my side. It's me. I'm here. I have not abandoned you. Even when you can't see me, I am still with you." My friends, the ones who are furloughed, found a mailbox full of toilet paper last week. A day later, a box of groceries appeared on their back doorstep, and their church was able to help with the prescription copay costs. Jesus is showing up in the form of neighbors and friends and their church community. Like Thomas, it's important to me to know that God bears scars, that God engages with us so completely as to be willing to be affected by humanity. That, for me, is evidence of a perfect God, a God who knows what it's like to stay up all night, longing for things to be different, and at the same time, trusting that things will work out in the scars that we've accumulated from our lived experience, and made whole by the grace of God, we are the body of Christ, loving and serving the Lord so that all who do not see may believe. May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
Standing together, let us affirm what we believe in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
For the Holy Church of God in all its diversity, which bears witness with one voice on this joyful day of the glad tidings that Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
For the whole bright earth, so lovingly created and even more lovingly redeemed, that it may sing of God's glory and majesty with the good news that Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
For the nations and peoples of the earth for whom Christ died, and for the hope that is offered to all through his resurrection.
The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
For all who serve on medical teams, including Anne, Christy, Lisa, Pete, Shannon, Allison, David, Ron, Lucy, Victoria, Deidre, Kathy, and Milena, and for all gathered in this common prayer that we, like the first disciples, may experience the joy of new life that proclaims, Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
For all who suffer in mind, body, or soul, including all whom we remember at this time.
Joy, Don, Catherine, Nancy, Ruthie, Sandy, Nancy, Anne, Jeannie, Carol, Dick, Carol, Nancy, Kay, and others whom we remember and name at this time.
That they may be comforted by the healing power and presence of our risen Lord.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
For all who have died, including those who we remember at this time, either silently or aloud. That in Christ who triumphs over death, that they may find light perpetual with our risen Lord.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. Rejoicing in the risen presence of our Lord, we commend all for whom we pray and ourselves to Christ, to whom we give thanks and praise now and forever. Now we will pray in the words our Savior Christ has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory,
forever and ever.
Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all our understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you this day and remain with you always. Amen.
Let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia.